on September 17th, 1996. That was actually on CD. It was released a little bit before that on vinyl. It's basically a cleansing. Ænima is the combination of Ænima, I guess is how you say it, Latin for soul. It's also in Jungian psychology, it's the feminine aspects of the male that the male suppresses, or that remain unconscious. And obviously Ænima, you all know what that is. This album actually won a Grammy for Best Metal Performance in 1998, 2 years later. Which I didn't know they gave Grammys for live performances. That's pretty cool. So I found from the Tool Fact, this guy Mike had sent in an iridology reading of the Ænima eye. Apparently it's very unhealthy. According to the study of iridology, the lighter area around the pupil is a sign of dropped transverse colon,
yeah.
Which feeds into the Ænima imagery as well. Like, they really know what they're doing here, every image. The darker green areas in the iris are a sign of drug use or chemicals in the body. The dark green circles are tiny deposits of the substance. The texture of the iris, the harsh waves in the background of the iris, are a sign of a body of low resistance and poor inherent ability to overcome difficulties. The starting of the second iris is screwed up too, but I don't think that iridology has anything to do with that. Yeah, I don't think iridology can tell you how to read a second iris on an eyeball. And it's interesting. I don't know if iridology can go as in depth as this, but in the liner notes of the album, they actually kind of admit to all of the drug references, at least in the album notes, to be ketamine, which is a dissociative and removes the self from a situation, which is also a big theme in this album. So just a few quotes to get us started. These are all taken from the Revolver book on Tool. But just as we mature as humans, with Ænima we try to be fueled more by spiritual ideas or more of a conscious mode of aiming things in the right place or trying to take more responsibility for our art. So we're going to see a directional shift from anger and from their heavier stuff, trying to get noticed, trying to get themselves out there. And this is how, hi, welcome. This is how Justin Chancellor joined the band. This was the first album that he was on, Paul Moore. They said that he quit, and really they fired him. And they admitted that much later, that they said that he quit, just to make it a little easier on him at the time. But Justin Chancellor was living in London and had loved them since the first EP came out. Adam called them up once Paul was gone, and they had already been writing Push It on the eulogy. So Justin learned those and auditioned, and Danny Carey actually said that from the audition, the way that he played the music wasn't really the deciding factor. It was the jam session that they had afterward that made it obvious that he was the one that was going to be most cohesive with the direction that they were trying to take. For me, the first couple records were the primal scream. As a lyricist and performer, the idea was to work out some issues and then move the fuck on. So here you are in your third year of telling the same story over and over again, which was a negative story to begin with and impacted your life in a negative way. And having to retell it every night is not so healthy. So right around the time of Ænima, I was trying to figure out a way to transmute that stuff and let it go, finding different paths to disintegrate that negativity. I did a lot of esoteric, spiritual, and religious research. I read a lot of mathematical and psychological books and just did a lot of introspection and a lot of sound mind, sound body studies. And that stuff helped take the record in a more esoteric, spiritual direction. But of course, while still hanging on to some of the emotions and some of the charged feelings. I know we were all doing a lot of psychedelics during that era, not that we hadn't for our whole lives, but there's no doubt that it lays a precedent and releases a more creative part of people's minds. It's scientifically proven. And I think we were able to share more personal things with each other and to dig a little deeper and expose those parts of our personalities or our psyches in a bolder and more revealing way. And that's where the music naturally went. When it comes to our artwork, I'm always thinking, let's do something that's never been done before, or how can we push this, how can we push something? I found this little indie CD that had a lenticular cover on it, but it moved. It had two frames of back and forth animation, and I just freaked out. Our manager found the little company that put it out, so we contacted them and told them we were thinking about doing possibly a million copies. I think we were the first commercial band to do that. Artistically, that's the kind of thing that really excites me. Which is awesome. I unfortunately could not find my Ænima album. Well, I found the CD case and then didn't find the
I had it in my car.
Yeah, you should have asked me. I have one of the ones.
You were working all day.
Shall I?
You can if you want, sure. It's pretty cool. Almost every picture in the jacket is a hologram, including the. It's actually a lady.
I thought you meant you needed the music.
No, I got the
okay,
music.
Okay, never mind. Because I only have the CD, I don't have the album.
Well, thanks, Steve.
So, in the first track,
anytime.
Stinkfist, this starts us right back with our root chakra orientation, and this whole album is just gonna move us up the light energy body. The very first line on this album is something has to change, so let's change it. Stinkfist uses fisting as a metaphor for attempting deep or meaningful connection amidst a culture that breeds alienation and overstimulation. Reaching beautiful new levels of intimacy, overcoming our cultural programming to continue to feel something or anything deeply. And this is another one of their songs that really forces the listener to overcome whatever hang-ups they have about disturbing imagery or things that they're not used to, because this, the nature of the song and the relationship that plays out is just remarkable. And if you're turned off by the word stink fist, you're not going to get the full picture. So we're literally reaching into a body from root to throat, activating their energy flow and cleaning blockages by temporarily becoming a block and reflecting someone's shadows back to them. Need to feel something to know we are alive. This is kind of a self-feeding cycle. The more we numb ourselves, the more we have to push ourselves to feel something, and the further we have to keep going, and really that's kind of the nature of a drug. And there's tons of people on Tool forums that will say that every song is a conversation between a drug and a drug user, but love itself is a drug. It's oxytocin. I mean, our brain releases certain chemicals that make us feel euphoric, and the point here is that pain can sometimes be greater than desensitization. And it really calls into question the nature of love, because love is not all puppy dogs and rainbows and My Little Pony, whatever.
My Little Pony is always love.
Yeah. Well, Tool is kind of shattering that Disney mentality here. The album begins by pushing boundaries on so many levels, again, even against the record companies. I mean, how can you advertise a video called Stinkfist on primetime and TV? Record companies aren't going to like that, but Tool doesn't give a shit.
What did they call it?
I don't know. What did they call it?
Does anybody ever
remember? Track number two.
Right.
Huh? What?
Track number two.
Track number two, that's right. I did read that.
That's great.
And it's not track number two. It's track number two. Yep.
And
well, at least they left something about the number two in there.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think that's what it was.
So this song kind of explores the motives of the dominant fister and the submissive fistee. They both are attempting to feel something here. And the borderline gets crossed in an extreme way, which really calls into question whether or not it was even a boundary in the first place. Who said it? And what does it feel like to let somebody cross that? And we wouldn't want it any other way, because the mind must constantly be pushed to continue evolving and seeking a more all-encompassing truth. This is necessary. And in the video that we're about to see, we have people made of stone that are desensitized by overstimulation. There's a huge theme of media, television going on. And one of the characters fingers the eyelid of another character, which is analogous to the anal fisting, and gives even more variety to the metaphor. And we can adopt that scenario to any given situation where intimacy is an issue.
Thank you.
is really interesting. Take my hand is in like hold my hand like a lover is saying take my hand is in like take me in you.
Yeah.
Oh, there was something interesting on one of the forums that I was looking at on that song. Someone posting under Anonymous said, because all Tool fans like to fight on the forums. That's what they do. They get really upset.
People like to fight on the internet, period.
Yeah, true. Tool, though, people want to be right for some reason. But somebody posted, you're all right because you're all wrong. And I really liked that. So we're going to kind of skip the music on the eulogy because it's really long and we're pressed for time. But it could be about Bill Hicks, an American comedic hero, about a close friend of Maynard's, which was probably Bill Hicks, about Jesus, L. Ron Hubbard, or any prophet or self-righteous saint, claims to be a saint. It also reveals the stages of grief, which are bitter, angry, and it could also be the death of a part of oneself, which would actually flow into age really well. So what's coming through is alive. This could either be birth or sex. The snake is theorized to be Maynard's father, or it could be his own ego. Or it could be his literal penis, depending on how you break this song down. It's also the Christian symbol for knowledge, primarily sexual knowledge. And then my blood before me would be his son, who was born a year and a half before this album came out. His son being an extension of himself, part of his own flesh. Also the Christian idea of symbolized by wine, which is the mark of original sin, which is related to sexual knowledge. And the piss to wine line is actually taking a negative and turning it into a positive. So the negative to positive, he doesn't want to make the same mistakes as the masculine entities in his life, which, as you've seen through the history of their body of work, Maynard was very abused in a lot of different ways by his family, or people claiming to be his family. And when his son was born, he kind of realized that he had to humble himself and prioritize that new life and not just his own life. Considerately killing me is a really interesting phrase because we're looking at not only ego death, but as we've talked about before, the French word for orgasm being my little death. This song is really sexy. I mean, if you break it down in terms of ideas of Amrita, of the elixir of immortality theorized throughout basically every mythology and history, what we're looking at is a mix of blood and semen to create life. And H is his son's middle initial, so that is exactly what he's talking about. And he's tearing down the old walls that he's built as a result of feeling damaged. He's sacrificing selfish desires in order to better take care of his responsibilities and to lovingly embrace his own mortality. Recognizing that all existence is the same energy, we have died, we will die, but we don't mind because we will continue to be born. And the snake is drowned, either in blood or wine or water, however you want to look at it. It's a physical washing away of ego, the power of childbirth and letting go of old patterns and traumas, allowing healing to begin. He is embracing change and shedding fear, it's known as catharsis or rebirth, kind of like a phoenix from the ashes. The music starts out all grungy and full of tension and then applies this pressure and then it gives way to this beautiful melody that's really gentle and it's just a complete change of pace and a moment of clarity, like as soon as that life is actualized for him. And Maynard has actually been quoted saying, ever seen those Warner Brothers cartoons where there's someone trying to make a decision and they have an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other? Of course, the angel is telling him to do the right thing, and the devil is telling him to do what would not be right. Well, sometimes you have this happen in real life, but it's not always that simple. Maybe it's friends telling us what we should or should not do, but their advice might not always be what's best for us. This song's called H. And he said that before a live performance, obviously. And like I said, H is Maynard's son's middle name. One fan said that he gave his son the middle name to remind him of how much heroin affected his life. I highly doubt that Maynard would name his son after heroin. I also know that Maynard's real middle name is Herbert, so it's probably a family name and a continuation of that. And I've never read or heard anything about Maynard ever being a heroin addict, ever. Have you, Alyssa? I don't know where they got that. Okay.
The most enthusiastic second opinion ever.
I mean, he's obviously done opiates, for sure. But I've never heard about him being a heroin addict. We get the rest of the lyrics that are really just the ego death and accepting that connection and understanding that by letting go of that part of yourself, you're not giving up yourself. You're simply becoming something else in association with this new energy. And somebody wrote about transhumanism that is sometimes abbreviated as H plus or lowercase h. And it's an international intellectual and cultural movement supporting the use of new sciences and technologies to enhance human physical and cognitive abilities and ameliorate what it regards as harsh aspects of the human condition, such as disease and aging. Basically, they're talking about genetic modification. And it's interesting to bring that into H, which comes right before 46 and 2, which is about humans evolving to the next level of chromosomes. I thought it was interesting. I don't think it necessarily has relevance for me personally, but you're right because you're wrong, right? I found this picture, Searching for Transhumanism. I thought it was really cool. It's like disco ball games made of circuitry. Robots.
Excellent, yes.
And some other fan theories is that there's an interesting correlation between first stanza and the story of Perseus and Medusa. What's going through is a lot. Perseus is not stoned when he enters Medusa's cave. It's crazy because everything around Medusa is stone. What's holding up is a mirror. Perseus holds up his shield. What's singing songs is a snake. It's Medusa's head reflected. Looking to turn his fist to wine. It's Perseus collecting his reward, which is her head. That's cool. And then someone else posted that H means half empty or half full, and it's the juxtaposition of Maynard's relationship to his father versus his son. And then someone else, New Paradigm Plants was this guy's username. What he had to say was really neat. He said, turn this piss to wine could be symbolic of the Vedic Soma cult and their practice of consuming Amanita muscaria, aka mana, the Holy Grail, the Round Table, the Blood of Christ, the Tree of Knowledge. Probably not, but the songs are here for us to experience the divine. No absolute, only transfinite understanding.
Transfinite.
Yes, I like that
That's
word a
lot. That's an interesting word.
I really like that word a lot. I was exposed to it linguistically like that for the first time yesterday, actually, from reading that. It was really good.
Hey, before you leave H, you really don't think there was any indication that Maynard ever was any kind of a heroin addict? You really don't think so?
I don't think that it wrecked his life to the point that
no.
he named his son.
I'm just saying.
Him. I think he definitely did opiates. I think he definitely was an addict.
Well, what sold me was like, someone feed the monkey while I dig in search of China White as Dracula as I approach the bottom.
Yeah.
That's definitely like straight up.
Yeah, but on that
anyways,
scene.
I just had to throw that in there before you moved off age.
Yeah, for sure. Useful Idiot, track 4, basically sounds like a record skipping. On the vinyl versions of this album, this track appears right at the end of the first side, and if you didn't know any better, you might think that H had ended and that this song was missing. The term, originated by the high-ranking Soviets, referred to the Soviet citizens whose loyalty to the party was unwavering. While the top party officials were living the good life, the average useful idiot was standing in line hoping that the bread wouldn't run out. but the useful idiots never questioned their master's actions or authority. They were the perfect citizens. Which, the anonymous poster there, was a useful idiot a tool. They really like to make idiots out of their fans. They really do. I mean, if you look at the new merchandise, the way that the font is done, tool looks like fool. But backwards, it's also loot, so why don't you just steal it? This is definitely, definitely one of the most dense songs on this album. Some of the ideas behind the song are based on the teachings of Melchizedek. Thank you. Here is part of an interview with him. There are three totally different kinds of humans on the earth, meaning that they perceive the one reality in three different ways, interpreted differently. The first kind of human has a chromosome composition of 42 and 2. They comprise a unity consciousness that does not see anything outside themselves as being separate from themselves. To them, there is only one energy, one life, one beingness that moves everywhere. Anything happening anywhere is within them as well. They are like the cells in the body. They are all connected to a single consciousness that moves through all of them. These are the Aboriginals in Australia. There might be a few African tribes left like this. Then, there's our level, comprising 44 and 2 chromosomes. We are a disharmonic level of consciousness that is used as a stepping stone from the 42 and 2 level to the next level of 46 and 2. These two additional chromosomes change everything. Rachel Wells was a tool, frequently asked questions, contributor. This is kind of long, but it's really, really good. I think she wrote this really well. Ænima and animas. In Jungian psychology, the anima refers to personality traits regarded as feminine that are often repressed into the unconscious of males, while the animas refers to traits regarded as masculine that are often repressed into the unconsciousness of females. Although suppressed from conscious awareness, the anima and animas influences our behavior in powerful ways. In most individuals, it is projected onto people of the opposite sex, and it counts for the experience of falling in love with someone we hardly know. As the unconscious pole of the self, the counter-ego represented by the anima animus can also be a guide into one's own unconscious realm. It is often experienced as the guiding female if you're a male, or male if you're a female, presence in dreams. The shadow. In Carl Jung's personality theory, the ego represents the individual's sense of personal self. The sense of personal identity is purchased, however, at the expense of certain tendencies that are rejected as non-self. According to Jung, these rejected traits come together as a kind of unconscious counter-ego, which he termed the shadow. We may become unduly anxious or irritated when in an environment or around a person that in some way reminds us of repressed aspects of ourself. If a person has rejected his or her own sex drive, for example, that person may feel irrational fear or anger around an overtly sexual individual. The shadow may appear as a person in one's dreams, usually as an individual of the same sex. Of all the archetypes, the shadow is the most powerful and potentially the most dangerous. It represents everything about ourselves that we fear and despise. The meaning of 46 and 2. According to... Our planet is covered with geometrically structured morphogenetic grids. These grids extend from about 60 feet under the Earth's surface to about 60 miles above the Earth, arranged in geometric patterns. Each species has its own grid, which supports life and connects the consciousness of its particular species. Before any species can come into existence or make an evolutionary step, a new grid must be completed. When a species becomes extinct, that particular species' grid dissolves. A new grid was completed in 1989, the Christ Consciousness Grid. This grid will allow humans to evolve into our next version, will develop two additional chromosomes, which are really geometrical images designed to resonate with our specific grid, for a total of 46 and 2. The main change will be a shift to the unity consciousness. Every cell in your body has its own consciousness and memory. You, the higher being that occupies your body, make the millions of different consciousnesses in your body work together as one being. How does this relate to this grid? Think of yourself as a cell and the grid as the higher being. We will still have individual consciousness, but will be united to form a higher being in order to work as one entity.
I think she worded that really well.
So, adding two chromosomes actually makes the genetic code more complicated. And I actually befriended a kid in Ohio named Dan through an old Facebook tool for him because of what he had to say about the parallel between altering the genetic language of the body versus altering the computer code. And he said that binary is simple code that takes a lot of energy and effort to operate, whereas Java plus scripting language is very complicated but incredibly easy to operate. So as we alter, hopefully naturally, our genetic makeup, the functionality of our physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual bodies may become easier and possibly more instinctual, more natural, and just flow. Oddly enough, 8 at 46 and 2. So...
imagine that.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is just
so it seems to me that sometimes we have to take a step back.
You know, some people only have 45 also.
Well, some people also already have 46 and 2.
That's true.
Yeah, it's autism or various...
splicing and the switch off there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I think, in spite of the theories about progressing to 46 and 2, I think Tool is kind of hinting that we need to take a step back through the shadow in order to fully realize what our next steps should be.
Adam and I had a very long, drawn-out conversation about the increasing number of genetic irregularities that seem to be popping up with each consecutive generation of humanity, and just odd little mutations that seem to be happening pretty much everywhere.
Like the little Chinese kid with cat eyes? I can see at night. Have you guys seen him?
No.
He has cat eyes. They're like... beautiful blue, the prettiest eyes I've ever seen.
And they
check him.
Well,
when you shine a light on them, they reflect green like a cat.
Why?
So he has more, he has like a second lens behind his eyes that reflects the light back. Because that's what makes him.
I don't know about that. They haven't really studied it, but I know he's got like.
Well, that's what makes their eyes glow in the dark.
More rods and cones or whatever. And yeah, he could see in the dark. They took him in the dark and wrote some stuff down, and he could read it in pitch black. It's ridiculous. It's on YouTube. Go check it out. It's amazing. The little dudes. He can't really go out in the sunlight, but you're right. It's going down.
So in 46 and 2, we actually get a continuation of the snake imagery. Maynard is a snake, like his father, crawling on his belly, shedding his skin. He's undoing the calluses and releasing old habits and defense mechanisms, muscle memory, as he calls it, thought patterns, what he's been clinging to. Crawling on my belly also inspires the vision of a child throwing a tantrum, victimizing one's whole self in order to avoid acceptance of a negative piece of oneself. Tool's really encouraging us to examine the shadow we project onto others and the world in order to accept and better ourselves, allowing the shadow to be a medium for transformation, softening our armor rather than building it up. The I Choose To portions include negative things. You know, he says, I choose to die, I choose to cry, I choose to kill, all these things. And he's really stressing the necessity of both forces, of good and bad, to manifest evolution and enlightenment. And the song, and especially the dialogue between fans about its meanings, is a wonderful example of the temporary nature of belief systems. We follow the rules of one system that makes sense to us until we encounter an anomaly within our mental framework that simply cannot fit into our definition of truth, and we're forced to take a step back and recalculate. Each chakra actually has what is sometimes referred to as a shadow emotion, the usual behaviors that are faced with the activation of each chakra. For the root, it's resentment and rigidity, which transmutes into acceptance, The sacral chakra is passionate manipulation or victimization and guilt, which gives way to creativity. The solar plexus is anger and greed, which gives commitment. Heart, you face fear and attachment, and it breeds compassion. The throat, you face denial and abruptness in favor of truth. The third eye, you deal with confusion and depression in order to gain intuition. And at the crown, you handle grief, which gives way to boundlessness. And in this song, we can see all of these emotions being dealt with in this single song, truly seeking to evolve the whole self through self-reflection and a willingness to accept. And this is actually an image from Carl Jung's big red book called Shadow. Message to Harry Man Back. It's a recording of the words of an uninvited Italian guest who came to Maynard's house one day, a so-called friend of a friend of a friend of Harry's. Before we finally managed to figure out that nobody really knew him, he had already emptied the fridge and run up a huge phone bill. He got kicked out of the house. It's Danny Carey. Harry Man Back is a pseudonym for the real recipient of the message, presumably a past roommate of Maynard's, Hotsy Minshot of Green Jello. Harry Man Back is also a character used in Bill Hicks' stand-up. It is an actual message recorded on Maynard's answering machine, but the band added the love poem sounding piano in the background, creating an interesting juxtaposition between this song, which is negative, and the industrial German track Dear Ira von Sotten, which is not mean at all. Yeah, it's cookies! Hooker. Hook.
Yeah, hook.
Hook with a penis.
Yeah.
That gives a whole new
hooker.
Meaning.
That sounds really painful.
Hooker. Yeah, so I'm not going to play this one because I'm pretty sure we've already heard it. I know most of us were at the show in Dallas. They opened with it. This song is pretty straightforward. If you can't figure it out, call me. I'll help you. Maynard may or may not be referring to a real fan, but he's basically calling consumers out as hypocrites if they judge others for selling out. The fan in the lyrics is wearing Dan's, drinking Coke, he's got pierced nipples, new tattoos, and he's criticizing Tool for sucking up to the man. I sold my soul to make a record. Here he's actually showing us that art is an extension of the spirit, and unfortunately in this society we have to make a living somehow. And this creates a sort of moral battle for the artist to be bringing something empty and impure, money, into a sacred spiritual sphere. We are all whores to culture. Selling our souls for products we don't need, perverting the sacred. We are all fucking each other and being fucked by the system. So there's really no one to point the finger at. We also have the phallic imagery again, suggesting that this particular fan was a hooker with a tool. The band, however sold out they may be, has never abandoned their message or artistic vision. As usual, Maynard is just whispering away in the song. Most notably at 1 minute and 40 seconds, he says something which can kind of be deciphered as consume, be fruitful, and multiply. Originally thought to be a Bill Hicks quote, it actually appears that he jacked it from the Bible. This is from Kabir on the Tool Fact, his wording there. He jacked it from the Bible.
Jacking it is great tool imagery.
Oh yeah, definitely. And then intermission, track 8, transitions from something heavy into something much more childlike as a buffer before Jimmy, which is about an incident that happened to Maynard's mom when he was 11. It's a fun palate cleanser that mimics the main guitar riff from Jimmy in an old organ, on an old organ of keyboard. It's very circusy. What?
It's like Calliope music.
It's great.
Yeah. To represent a child, Jimmy actually signifies Maynard's real name, James Herbert Keenan, Jimmy being a nickname for James. At age 11, his mother, Judith Marie, suffered a stroke, which left her paralyzed and confined to a wheelchair for the remainder of her life, which happened to be 10,000 days. We'll get to that. Number 11 is insane. So, relationship stability. One and one are 1, 11. Could be a sign of interdependence in a relationship, the desire to stand with his mother again, regaining stability and safety, or it could be the return of innocence that his older self desires. 11 also has a variety of esoteric meanings, and if I don't talk about one that you guys know about, then please chime in. You know, a lot of you use it. In astrology, 11 would be the next step beyond Pluto. Pluto is 10, which is transformation, and the next step is Haumea, which is the Hawaiian goddess of fertility, which actually makes a lot of sense since his mom is the focus of this song. Superstring theory is an attempt to explain all of the particles and fundamental forces of nature in one theory by modeling them as vibrations of tiny supersymmetric strings. In theoretical physics, M theory is an extension of string theory in which 11 dimensions are identified. Because the dimensionality exceeds that superstring theory's in 10 dimensions, proponents believe that the 11-dimensional theory unites all. When traveling linearly, maybe, I'm not sure quite how it works once you get into those upper dimensions. Upon reaching the 11th dimension, it immediately puts you back to 1. So 1 and 1 are 11 and 1. Yeah. 11 could also be a representation of a DNA spiral helix and the digital code of awakening, 1111. In numerology, 7 plus 4 is the universe plus the earth, equals 11, which is hidden energies. In alchemy, 1 is a number, numeral, and the name of the glyph representing that number. It is the natural number following 0 and preceding 2. It represents a single entity. 1 is sometimes referred to as unity or unit as an adjective. For example, a line segment, blah, 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 blah. Chinese refer to one as yang, masculine, celestial. It is seen as an auspicious number. One is the monad. Christian, God the Father, the Godhead. Hebrew, Adonai, the Lord, the Most High, the I Am, the Hidden Intelligence. Islamic, one refers to one as God, as unity, the absolute, self-sufficient. One as meaning spirit, God, from which all things come. It is the very essence, the monad. In Taoism, Tao begets one begets two begets three, and three begets all things. 11. In the tarot, 11 in the major arcana is typically the card for justice or strength and fortitude, but in Crowley's Thoth deck, 1 is the magician, sun and Mercury, Aries, and the magician shows that we're aware of the power in life. It can be a symbol for all the creative skills and ideas inside. Most people do not really act, they just react, being driven from one situation to the next. The magician tells that a power is ready to use as soon as it is recognized, to see and go the own way. The negative side of the card could mean that the free run of energy is blocked, that we can feel the energy but can't use it. This could mean fear and restlessness, even the fear to go insane. Energy tends to explode when not finding the next. Finally, there's negative aspects in the abuse of energy.
Signifies a great flowing energy from above down directly toward the rock. The magician is the instrument, exactly. And since all the other things have to do with.
The
magician is the tool, if you will.
Right, and so this is kind of found in the middle of the album. Stinkfist that you start with is a moving up, and then here we kind of get this stationary sort of self-realization mode, and then in Ænima we just get it sucked down. So it's a cleansing.
It's the beginning of the Fibonacci sequence.
Yeah.
1-1.
And let's see. 11 in the Thoth deck is passion or lust, also known as Babylon, which is, if you've ever seen the seven-pointed star that Tool uses all the time, that is the symbol of Babylon. She has Venus in Leo. If you know anything about astrology, that means her love is very fiery, ferocious.
Does the Freedom Tower have seven sides?
Freedom?
Does it?
Does it?
What's the Freedom Tower?
Oh, the
Freedom Tower is what?
The new tower that they built where the World Trade Center used to be, that's all triangles.
Yeah, I don't watch TV.
I bet. I don't. Oh, I do, with my rabbit ears.
Okay.
I'll let you know. I'll look up the architectural specs.
So 11,
it's a new tower,
the passion, is the step into the second decade of the major arcana, the point where the journey into the inner depth begins. In other decks, this trump is called the power, a symbol for the mastery of our own animal side. Crowley named the card lust, and most people don't really think of mastering their inner animal, but enjoy it full tilt. And then at the end of this song, we get Glow Child Glow. You gotta find the light and let your light shine. Activate your energy body, transmute your shadow by emitting your own light. Physically, we are actually emitting light, reflecting light, and glowing with the same brilliance as the creatures at the bottom of the ocean. Think of a snake or any being that that perceives visibly in infrared heat. And consider the heat put off by a warm-blooded animal. We are light beings, literally. And he says it at the end of the song, glow, child, glow. The song is also related to the solar plexus chakra, where we find our sense of self, independence and interdependence, and commitment. And that's right here, it's right in the middle. It's right in the middle of the album. We get Dear Eye of Unsotten. I'm gonna play this one. Classic misdirection, exposing us to our own incorrect assumptions. This is not a Nazi rally. It is a recipe for magical hash cookies. And the title is a play on words that literally translates as the eggs of Satan, representing the ball of Satan. For the recipe, the speaker specifically calls for no eggs. This is because after adding a knife tip of Turkish hashish, the baker must speak the magic words Zim salabimba ba zaladu zaladimba, which is a voodoo phrase meant to invoke Satan's balls into the cookies to replace the eggs. Nothing like a little demon jizz to spice up your special cookies. This also draws a really interesting reflection between eggs and balls. The song is a great example of how we keep getting this total mind-body activation and cleansing interspersed with absolute ridiculousness. Tool has always shown an odd sense of humor, but in an elegant tribute to Bill Hicks, Ænima is full of humor. This may or may not also tie into the band's furthered exploration of esoteric knowledge in the making of this album, which would undoubtedly lead them through Discordianism.
What?
T-O-E-E is the sect of Discordianism founded by Malekwips the Younger and Omar Khayyam Ravenhurst. I think that was in 1957. Yeah, you know. And is known as the Paratheo-Animetamistichood of Eris Esoteric, a non-profit, irreligious disorganization, and the Principia Discordia tells about POEE in particular, as well as Discordianism in general. Principia Discordia is all online. The whole book is on there. Please read it. It's amazing.
Second book.
What? You started it?
Yes.
Okay.
In Britain, they don't say that's four decimals. They say six. That is their slang equivalent. I think it does.
Bollocks.
Oh, perfect.
Bollocks. I got kicked in the neck.
And the song is actually speculated to be a tribute to Einstürzend Neubauten. And I've never heard anybody say their name, and I've been listening to that band for like 4 years now. So if I'm saying it wrong, please help me.
That's correct.
Anybody
no,
know?
You're correct.
Yes.
Cool. Push It! Push It is a combination of Push It On Me and Shit On Me. This imagery is reflective of the direction of movement in Stinkfist, where our journey inward began. You saw that gap again today while you were begging me to stay. The song strikes me as very sexual in nature, and unlike Stinkfist, it seems more vagina-oriented. There's a femininity to it, and a comfort found in the gap, otherwise he wouldn't keep going there. When it is entered, masculine and feminine disappear into one balanced being. It's that something irresistible, the desire to love and to care. But the song is also the struggle to integrate the fact that you were wrong about someone and to accept the temporary nature of relationships. It's the tug of war in choosing freedom from a cycle or great passion alongside great suffering. It's an exercise in awareness and patience. The gap progresses to staring down the hole again. These are both empty concepts, void of physical texture. There's a numbness in the pattern, and the process of desensitization has led to greater and greater struggles to prove that we can still feel. It's so cold and sterile that there isn't even a borderline to cross anymore. Before performing the song, Maynard asked, have you ever loved someone so much that you had to kill them?
Yeah.
Spiritually, I think this could translate to a dismantling. As reflections of one another within a relationship, sometimes we must be the shadow for each other. I must destroy your ego in order to sustain my own, and vice versa. This is an equal and opposite reaction to the intimate self-activation reflections found in Stinkfist. The enlightenment and self-evolution process is a spiraling one. These are not experiences we will face just once. It is a slow and steady struggle to better oneself, to be patient and compassionate while facing one's shadow, because there always will be more light and more love to give. The song could also be referring to the relationship with one's own ego. The gap could represent the space between his lower level primal consciousness and his higher self. Take care not to make me enter. If I do, we both may disappear. His higher self is the realization that there is no self, but his ego doesn't want to give up. This is an ancient Indian philosophy known as Anatman, the absence of self as a means to detachment, thereby ending suffering. There's no love and fear is actually an inversion of chapter 1, this is chapter 4 of John, verse 18. There is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Choke this infant here before me could be referring to the ego battle and sacrificing our selfish desires in the interest of protecting our children, or it could be referring to immature people and those that we struggle with. What are you but my reflection? We don't want to be judged by others, and we are all here to reflect and project. Here we are reminded of the Ænima, the unconscious feminine aspect in the male Jungian psychology. Unfortunately, the main character in the story is forced to reject his reflection. Rest your trigger on my finger, bang my head upon the fault line. He is blaming the other person for blaming him. All he wants to do is escape this feeling of heaviness that comes with this kind of negative cycle. That pain extends so deep in many places that he still feels alive there, which is why he continues to participate, to be just as guilty as the other party until his survival is threatened. He experiences a calm in the realization that he has no choice but to leave. Sometimes the best things we can do for someone we truly love is recognize that they would be better off without us. And perhaps we would be better off without them. Accepting this does not make it much easier. The music crescendos with tension, escalating through regret and warning, until finally releasing all of the frustration and cutting the cord. This could also be childbirth, from the perspective of a fetus, not ready to be born, afraid of what lies beyond the void. This is a very heart-oriented battling for an integration of compassion. In actuality, many of these songs are focused through the heart. Things would not be so difficult if we didn't care so deeply. Somebody posted on an H forum, this is one of Tool's only love songs. All of Tool's songs are love songs. All of them. Every single one. and a fan theory. I think this song might even have something to do with the Gnostic idea of archons, based upon my understanding of it, inner demons, a mind that may be from outside our own. It never shuts up and can put us in a really bad place when we try and quiet the flow, stopping the internal dialogue. Cesaro, some ability. It seems that the baby crying is not Maynard's son, Devo. It has been suggested that it's just a sample taken from Fried Green Tomatoes or the show Absolutely Fabulous. Either one of those seems retarded, which could be absolutely right.
You're right, because you're wrong.
Yeah. The title is the name of a mathematical theorem describing a method of adding certain infinite series. As for what the segue means or why it's here, we may never find out. But someone on lyric interpretation suggested it's about his love of cats.
Well, I know.
Okay. Anima, the song is spelled differently than the album, presumably because they mean two different things. Anima, the album, is more closely related to the anima, or the soul or inner self of a person, the inner self, not the external persona of a person, as opposed to the persona that is in touch with the unconscious, and the unconscious feminine aspect of a male. While Ænima, the song, is all about the anal cleansing. Shut up. Basically, fuck anyone who doesn't think for themselves. This planet has a history of natural disaster and mass extinction. We should really take this opportunity to care for things that will aid in our survival, our growth, our well-being. We don't have to give in to the distraction of the media and our instant gratification culture. Here, LA is personified as a hub of bullshit, or the anus, in the Ænima metaphor. Materialism and desensitization. This song pays homage to Bill Hicks' album Arizona Bay, which fantasizes about California breaking off into the ocean. Time to bring it down again. Don't just call me pessimistic. Try and read between the lines. I can't imagine why you wouldn't welcome any change, my friend. Here, Maynard makes the distinction, the necessary distinction, between pessimism and embracing deconstruction as a step towards positive change. This is an exercise of the throat chakra, of accurately expressing an idea and seeking truth. We can all live much happier, more peaceful, and more fulfilling lives if we stop basing our self-worth on money and looks and fast cars and titty bars. There must be a shift in values to a more tribal awareness, a consciousness for the human race, a conscience for the human race, a respect for the mother of us all that sustains us in every way, and the sacrifice of selfish desires while prioritizing universal ideals. If this shift doesn't happen, Mother will take care of herself and set things right as she must to guarantee the survival of all life, and not just human life. Here we are reintroduced to the water imagery of Undertow and its association with the root chakra. Unlike the emotional battle of the previous album, Ænima encourages us to grow and to be self-sufficient, to learn to swim. The waters rose and rose, and here we see them begin to break. We align ourselves with a collective light greater than our individual glow, and we pray for the waters to purge the muck and be washed away. The song is full of self-empowerment, and in spite of its acceptance of death, this is a remarkably uplifting song, I think. When I saw them in Oklahoma City, 2010, at the beginning of the show, Maynard said he just had it on good authority that it was okay to take our clothes off, embracing our metaphorical clothes. And then they closed with Ænima, and right before they played Ænima, he said, now would be a good time to put your clothes back on, and just remember, when you go back out into the world, that everything is going to be okay. And then they played this, which is like, so awesome. I think my favorite time I've seen this song was at Lollapalooza. I had Lake Michigan on one side, all the way to the horizon, downtown Chicago on the other, and the art museum with a gigantic pirate flag on it right behind their stage. And everyone in this crowd of probably 100,000 people is not looking at the band. They're all screaming the lyrics at the buildings. It was really cool. I'm not gonna play the video, I already played the song. Ions. They're supposed to be good ions. They're found in high doses near waterfalls, streams, forests, etc. Negative ions have reportedly beneficial effects on humans, increased metabolism, higher resistance to ailments, and a generally more happy attitude. Positive ions, on the other hand, are bad. They can be found in mass quantities in cities, airports, garbage dumps, etc. Also, computer monitors output a large amount of positive ions. And of course, positive ions are supposed to have the opposite effects on humans. Depression, weight gain, sickness, etc.
The concentration of my hours and hours of clicking on the internet is probably not the best thing in my life.
There's a concentration of positive ions before thunderstorms, and then a concentration of
negative ions. Thunderstorms charge those ions. They usually make people more happy after they're dead.
It's like the sunshine and the storms.
I'm gonna go ahead and skip to Third Eye since that song is so long.
It's just gonna repeat.
So here we get an introduction by Bill Hicks, who references the third eye a lot in his comedy. Watching TV is like taking black spray paint to your third eye. Quote by him. It has also been suggested that this song is a reference to Don Juan and Carlos Castaneda's The Original Teachings of Don Juan. Don Juan was a shaman who consumed peyote cactus buttons for phosphorus and desert buttons.
Don Juan wanted to make it today, but he couldn't make it.
Don Juan couldn't make it?
No. I tried to bring Don Juan in.
He's still here in spirit.
Right.
Is he coming over to the house later?
Maybe.
Awesome.
I'm gonna call him.
Cool. Apparently, peyote glistens in moonlight. I didn't know that. That's cool. And it's used in psychedelic ceremonies by Don Juan. The Holy Crow and Second Sun in the lyrics are also contained in Castaneda's book. So what is the third eye? We learned a bit about this in our section on lacrimology. The third eye, physically, is the pineal gland contained within the brain, which secretes dimethyltryptamine, a trace amine neurotransmitter, which I had never seen that word in reference to dimethyltryptamine, but I thought it was cool and it was kind of a reflection, amine, enema, melatonin, and serotonin. It regulates our waking, sleeping, and dreaming states to create the whole being, which in the Upanishads, an ancient Indian text, apti, utkarsa, and niti are the words for the waking, sleeping, and dreaming states, and the first letter of each of those combined is what creates om, the sacred syllable, which is the mantra for activating the third eye. And then this was from Wikipedia. Syllables mentioned in all the Upanishads, especially elaborated upon in the Taittiriya. I can't read Sanskrit. Set forth as the object of profound religious meditation, the highest spiritual efficacy being attributed not only to the whole word, but also to the three sounds, ah, u, of which it consists. Akara means form or shape, like earth, trees, or any other object. Ukara means formless or shapeless, like water, air, or fire. Makara means neither shape nor shapeless, but still exists, like the dark energy content of the universe. When we combine all three syllables, we get om, which is a combination of akara, ukara, and makara. The song can be easily related to a psychedelic experience, the ego death. The face that is bright blue and shimmering is actually pictured in the liner notes in the album, but could also be the alien familiarity of seeing yourself in the mirror while under the influence of a visionary substance. Blue is also the color representing the throat chakra and intelligent communication, pure intelligent communication with oneself. So came out to watch you play. These lyrics are reminiscent of an inner child or a former self perspective of innocence and purity. By embracing the shadow and facing the negative aspects of ourselves, we can often succumb to belittling ourselves or thinking we are bad in some way. Activation of the third eye gives us awareness of a plan, for lack of a better word, greater than our own, allowing us to embrace changes that we may not understand. The imagery of the word crying does not give us a sense of ease. This can be a difficult process, but it is one that may be necessary to our survival as a species. In Hindu belief, the third eye is represented with a red dot, bindi. It refers to your consciousness. Open up that third eye, consciousness, and don't feed into Maya, illusions, for it is just a distraction. You have to think for yourself and not be persuaded. The first time that I heard this song, I thought it was about releasing your anger and not backing away from it, because anger is such a clear and beautiful emotion. In Hindu texts, Lord Brahma created Shiva from his third eye when he was angry, thus creating the god of ignorance, destruction, and anger, Shiva. And that's from Kim Irani from lyricinterpretations.com. Thought that was an interesting breakdown of how this god of destruction, which we just kind of faced in Ænima, was born from the third eye through the processing of anger.
That just sounds so much like that moment when you get so angry and cry.
Like a mom.
Yeah. It's that moment, except when you're a god, apparently you cry out of your third eye.
Where else would you cry out of?
Well, you do too.
Everything.
You cry out of your third eye too. It ups the neurotransmitters. The third eye chakra is represented by a two-petal lotus, signifying the duality of things, but the oneness that is found in the gray area, the gap, if you will. It allows us to find peace and stillness in the cosmic storms that sometimes surround us and flow through us. It is where we hone our intuition and overcome depression. That's Ænima. From Stinkfist to Third Eye.